There's such rewards of consistency. It's unbelievable. The power and rewards of consistency. It blows me away. And I've been very far from perfect. God knows it. I am what I am by the grace of God. But when I was sent to the hospital in 1961, almost 1962 thereabouts, around then, diagnosed with nephritis, a kidney disease. It was then that I had my first encounter with the Holy Spirit, as you know about, most of you know about. And it was at an early age I had to learn to be consistent. Consistent in my doctor visits, consistent in believing I would be healed. Consistent that this thing would go away and never come back again. And God rewarded my consistency. Now only the cross of Christ can get the glory. Only Christ can get the glory. But folks, I'm telling you, there's power in consistency. Listen to me. And I say this so respectfully with nobody in mind. Sometimes people think he's talking about me. Well, maybe I am. If I am, I'm not aware of it. Could it be that the Holy Spirit is talking to you? But people change jobs and jobs and jobs and jobs. Listen, sometimes things happen in life. I understand that. Sometimes businesses go out of business. I understand that. But there's something about being rooted and grounded in a place for a period of time where God eventually promotes you. He eventually promotes you. Where others quit and talk ugly about the one that puts food on their table. You say, well, I've worked for it. Yeah, but who created that job? You or the person you're working for? There's something to think about. But there's something about consistency. And in 1961, 1962, I discovered the power of consistency by praying regularly, even as a young child, consistently praying, consistently giving God praise. Through the years, I've learned through the power of Christ to be consistent. In 1975, when I entered Bible college at the age of 18, I look back now and I say this with anguish, that just about everybody that graduated from my class, hardly any of them, if any of them, are in ministry today. Yet they have their diploma. They have their degree. The power and rewards of consistency, of keep going and not quitting, and keep going and not quitting. But I don't feel like going on. That's when it's time to go on. But I don't feel like working out. That's when it's time to work out. But I don't feel like coming to church. That's when it's time to come to church. But I don't feel like giving. That's when it's time to give. But I don't feel like giving more. That's the time to give more. I'm telling you, folks, that woman with the issue of blood, for all those years, she hemorrhaged. She hemorrhaged for years. And for years, she went to every doctor. She was a wealthy woman, as the Bible indicates, because she seen the finest of specialists. And finally, she said, this Jesus, whoever he is, if I can just touch him, if I can just touch him, if I can just touch him. And it were the church folks, the ones in the way of blocking her miracle. It was not the unrighteous. It was the righteous blocking her miracle. If I can just touch him, consistency. You know the story. Finally, she touches him. He turns around and says, who touched me? I tell you, when you do something that gets God's attention, look out, heaven's... When you do something that gets God's attention, heaven will rain upon you. Hear me. You just give God a tip and you'll get a tip in return. But when you do something like Cornelius, when he offered an offering to God, the angel stopped and the Lord said, my God, I smell. You see, in the kingdom of God, there are fragrances. That's why in the Holy of Holies, they burnt incenses because God, ladies, let me tell you something about your perfumes. God is in the sense. Now, men, that may not make sense. But women, God is in the sense. There's smells of righteousness in the Spirit. There's smells of holiness in the Spirit, in the Holy of Holies. There's a stench of sin. You can smell offense. You can smell division. I'm talking about the Spirit. And when you learn to be consistent in offering God your best, your all, it gets his attention. And when it gets his attention, then he says, I know I could use you. Let me tell you the greatest compliment God could ever pay Jim DiPalma. Those of you watching, the greatest compliment God could ever tell you, listen to me, kids, is not, son, daughter, I love you. That's not the greatest compliment. God loves us all. God loves us all, and he loves us all unconditionally. He loves the heathen as much as he loves the non-heathen. He loves the sinner as much as he loves the saint. But the greatest compliment that God could ever tell you is the same compliment that I could tell you. And that is this: God saying, I can trust you. Mm-hmm. God loves everybody, but he does not trust everybody. God loves everyone, but he does not trust everyone. If I cannot be an obedient vessel with my tithe, my offering, my first fruit, then God cannot trust me. When God says, I trust you, then you have become a friend of God. I love godly songs, and I love music of today. But some of the words and some of the songs, we have to be very careful about how we're singing about being a friend of God. You may be a son of God, but are you a friend of God? You may be born again, but does he trust you? Can he trust you? Can he trust me to be a gatekeeper in the house of the Lord? Because if I cannot be trusted as a gatekeeper in the house of the Lord, I'll never be entrusted with the pulpit of God. And there's something about consistency. Finishing the race. You say, but so-and-so is ahead of me. It's okay. God's not looking at whether you're ahead of them or not. He's looking at you as one who finishes the race. Consistency. There's power in it. I was 18 in 1975. And I look today and I hurt that these men are no longer in ministry. They went to all these years of college to receive an education. But what have they done with it? I'm not putting them down. I'm talking about being consistent, where maybe the world offers you a better job than being called by God. Maybe God ordained a ministry for you to where you're making $20,000 a year and you're thinking to yourself it's not enough, but somebody in the world says, I've got a job for you here with benefits to make $50,000. But your life is not contingent on how much money you make. Your life is contingent on how God can trust you, and he can trust you when you're obedient to him. And the only way you can be fully obedient to him is when you're consistent in your walk with God. Now, we all fall short. Isn't that good news? It is, but it's not. We all fall short, but we have to consistently keep getting back up. The Bible says a righteous man may fall 7 times, and that's not an excuse to fall. But a righteous man may fall 7 times, but the Lord will pick him up. Consistency, Lord, check my heart. Consistency in repenting. Consistency in forgiving. Consistency to go to my brother and my sister. Consistency in what I eat, in what I drink. Consistency in my sleeping patterns. Consistency in my walk with my wife or my husband or my children or with my pastor or with my church or with my job or with my friends. Somebody shout consistency. There's power and rewards of consistency. Applying and activating patterns. Not negative patterns, not patterns of lust and covetousness, but patterns that will lead to say, somebody else may not want to do it. And yes, it makes it more difficult for me because I used to have a prayer partner. I used to have a workout partner. And now it's just me. Well, let me tell you, it's not just you. It's you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Consistency, discipline. People want to be disciples, but they don't want to be disciplined. They want to be among the crowd, but when the cloud, the glory comes and he reveals things in us, then things change. Consistency. to have a game plan. Consistency. Faithful. Keep going and going. Consistency. Following your conviction. Not following the crowd. Not following the money. In 1981, I moved to Chicago. I gave up a pension. I gave up insurance. I gave up my family. I have a picture of my daughter, Janelle. Yes. Put that on the screen, please. Rebecca, she was just 3 years old. She was 3 years old. Her and I were like she was my little girl. My little girl, my baby. It was in 1981. She was just 3 years old. I consistently loved her. I never abandoned her. Never! But I placed her on the altar. I didn't know much about Jezebel spirits in those days. But consistency, folks. Just 2 days ago. 2 days ago! She's the aggressor. Talking to me. Calling me. Hey, how you doing? Doing okay? She's the one now. Reapplied for college. To get a law degree. Pace University. She works as a waitress. She works as a babysitter. She works as a dog sitter. She has a son, 6 years old, my grandson. And she gets everything. She's a single woman. She's been beat. She's been abused. But she's consistent. And she's just one example. I could use my other two children. But consistency. There's power, folks, in consistency. Consistency in prayer. Consistency in giving. Consistency in showing up. And not living according to my rules. There's power. Malachi 3:6 says, I'm the Lord God, I change not. Consistency. Deuteronomy 31:6 and Hebrews 13:5 both say, I will never leave you nor forsake you. That's the Lord being consistent. God the Father being consistent. God the Son being consistent. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Consistency. John 14:16, the Helper, the Holy Spirit, He will abide with you forever, forever. Consistency. And as we end this year, going into the new year, oh, no, we're not perfect, but consistency. In 1981, I moved and I left my pension behind. I left good pay behind, not for another job or anything, because nothing was promised me. And as most of you know, within weeks, I became senior associate pastor at that time of one of the fastest growing churches in America, within a few weeks. But I kept fighting. I kept fighting in mental warfare. Mental warfare. I had these little kids coming up to me in church services wherever I'd preach. Wherever I'd preach, these little kids would come up to me and hug me wherever I'd go. And I'm thinking about my own Rebecca. I'm thinking about my mother. I'm thinking about my father. My finances, all I have is my clothes on my back, my books, my car, and only money. No money, but only money set aside to take care of my baby. God looks at consistency. Consistency. And I came to Chicago. Look where we're at, church. I said, look where we're at. I didn't say, look where we've been. I said, look where we're at. If you only knew my story. In 1992, the Howard Johnson's Hotel in Elgin. Now it's a different hotel. We'd go there. After the meeting, my wife would look at me and say, let's quit this thing. Not ministry, not life, this thing. At the time, being prepared for World Overcomers Church, she'd say, come on, let's just quit tonight. I say, no, babe, let's give it one more week. Just one more week. The following week, I'd look at her and I'd say, let's quit this week. She'd say, no, one more week. And we go back and forth and back and forth. And here we are, folks, nearly 25 years later. There's power in consistency. 2005, open heart surgery. Massive surgery. Stopped breathing for nearly two minutes. And then a week later, 1 week to the day, I'm sitting at the kitchen table. I thought I was having a massive heart attack. 1 week, I still have the stitches in my chest. I thought I was having a massive heart attack. How can this be? I just had massive open heart surgery. I already stopped breathing for nearly 2 minutes. I was already starting to see lights and hearing people sing Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound, when we've been there 10,000 years. But something within me said, you're not done. Consistency. And I was rushed to the nearby local hospital here on Barrington Road. It was Alexian Brothers or St. Alexian. I get confused between Alexian and St. Alexian, but you know what I'm talking about. And they found out that I had AFib, where my heart was having an irregular heartbeat, which is usually quite common after the surgery I had. They didn't have to shock me or anything. They just gave me a few pills, and I was good as new. And on Thanksgiving morning, I'll never forget Thanksgiving morning, they came to me with the menu. The cardiologist was in the room. He was almost in the room. But one of the nurses or somebody came with a menu on Thanksgiving Day. Those of you that know me know that Thanksgiving Day is one of my favorite days of the year. And they came with the menu for Thanksgiving Day. What would you like, ham or turkey, Thanksgiving Day? And I said, Lord God, if I have to be here today, nevertheless, not my will be done, but thy will be done. But Lord, I know in my heart where I want to be. Minutes later, Dr. Mason, who's now retired, he came in the room and he says, I'm clearing you. You're being discharged this morning. My family that flew in from Florida, didn't fly in to come to see me in a hospital bed. They came to my house that we may fellowship and carve the turkey and give thanks together. But I had to learn. I had to learn through the surgery, through the setback. It was really not a setback, but it was a comeback. It was a setup to where now my heart is stronger than ever. The power of consistency. Because during that whole time, I had to praise him. There were times from my hospital bed, I was half drugged. But I had my wife call the church on Wednesday night to say, I love you. You're going to have a wonderful Wednesday and a tremendous Thursday. I wasn't saying it the way I'm saying it now when you're all tubed up. But consistency of just keep praising God. Consistency of keep sowing and keep giving and keep living and keep showing up and keep loving. Consistency in prayer, consistency in praise, consistency in standing, consistency in sowing, consistency in showing up. These are not words, but these are the words of the Lord. Consistency in speaking the word. Consistency in examining yourself. Consistency in submission and accountability. Consistency in running the race. But I'm tired. Yeah, we're all tired. But there will be a day it'll take us all home and say, well done, good and faithful servant. Or he'll say, depart from me. I knew you, but I never knew you. See, there's something about trust. When God can trust you, the floodgates open. When he can trust you with money, he'll give you money. When he can trust you with time, you'll have more than enough time. When he can trust you with lives, he'll give you lives. When he can trust you as a spiritual father, he'll give you spiritual sons. When he can trust you as a spiritual, I'm talking to the choir today. Help me, somebody. Consistency in fighting the fight. Consistency in growing in grace. Hear me. Consistency with a fresh anointing. Hear me. Consistency in sometimes we have to change things around so we don't get in that rut. So that we're not in that standstill. Consistency. Sometimes it's a little tweak. Consistency in spreading the good news of your faith in Christ. Consistency in studying to show yourself approved. Consistency of working until he comes. Oh, and I could think of people from Noah to Abraham, Isaac, Elijah, Daniel, David, Joshua, the three Hebrew boys, blind Bartimaeus, son of David. If I can touch him. To finally where Jesus said on the cross, it is finished. The power of consistency. It's not the greatest team that always wins the World Series. It's not the greatest team that wins the Super Bowl necessarily. But it's the team that's been consistent with the game plan. I've seen people make it to the major leagues with less talents than those in the minor leagues. I've seen some of these King County Cougars that have more talent than some in the major leagues. The key is not how good you are or how talented you are. The key is in consistency. Consistency. And consistency is a rough road. Consistency to say, you know what? I'm not going to cheat on her. I may not desire her, but I'm not going to cheat on her. There's a difference. And God can even bring that desire back. Consistency. But it all means, God, I surrender. My life is yours. It's not an easy road. You say, but I get discouraged. We all do. But consistently praise. Consistently worship. That's why people want a different gospel today. Or they want the old gospel, but they want to reformulate it and put their own spices, and they're choking on their own saliva. in the spirit. But be consistent. As this year is winding down, be consistent. Let's go into the new year with the spirit of consistency. You can only accelerate with the three F's, the fuel, the fire, the force. This year, God's put some fire under our butts, has he not? Maybe he put some fire under your butt. Some have taken it and gotten offended. Some have taken it and gotten closer. Fuel! Fire! It burns, it ignites. Force is penetration. Fuel smells, but it gets you to your destination. Consistency. But I'm just human. Consistency. So was Abraham when he put his son on the altar. Consistency. So here we are in December. May this be a December to remember. May we catapult into a new year to have a continuation of acceleration. You're not the only person going through what you're going through. Be encouraged. Be encouraged today. There's a fine line between comforting the afflicted and afflicting the comforted. But today, through God's grace and his strength, you can, you will do all things through Christ. This is not just a Sunday pep talk. This is a Monday devotional. You may have a trying Tuesday or a worrisome Wednesday or a turbulent Thursday in the natural. But in the realm of the Spirit, we're entering into a new realm. Not just a new year, but a new realm. And God's calling out his core as he says, "Behold, I come quickly." Behold, I come quickly, he says. He who has an ear, let him hear and apply. And therefore there is now, now, young lady, now, young man, no condemnation to those in Christ. But shake it off. Shake it off. Consistently shake it off. Consistently start to ignore the voices of the enemy. Consistently hear the word of the Lord. And watch and see. As we watch our New Year's Eve video in a couple of weeks, all the things that took place, say, "Wow, that did happen." Yes, and it brings back memories and it puts a spark in you. And it electrifies you. So today, let me remind you, you don't have to wait to watch a video or get a recap on what the Lord did a year ago, because he's doing it even now. And he's doing it yesterday. And he's doing it tomorrow. Whether you see it or not, you may not be where you want to be, but you're nowhere where you used to be. This has been the word of the Lord.